local, live, and Catholic. Welcome to Morning Offering with Ron and Dave on Annunciation Radio. Here are your hosts, Ron Finn and Dave Vacheresse.
Well, here it is, Tuesday already. Man, this week is flying by, isn't it, Dave?
It absolutely is. And I want to jump right into this because we have so many important things to discuss today. And I don't want to be heavy right off the bat, but sometimes you just got to do the thing. Pumpkin pie or apple or cherry?
You know, there's been a longstanding tradition in my family.
And I have to admit this. I should tell people this. I didn't give you any indication that I was going to ask you this question on the air. It's not fair. It's not fair. But
all pie is good pie.
All pie is not
true. Depends
on
my mood.
Don't like the shepherds.
I would put pumpkin in third place, though.
You put pumpkin in third.
Yeah. So I'd go probably, depending on my mood, cherry, apple, pumpkin, or apple, cherry, pumpkin. Unless there's a cream pie involved. If there's a Boston cream pie,
goodness.
Or especially one of those peanut butter, pies.
Yeah.
Oh.
Even better than apple or cherry?
Yeah, I'm afraid so.
Yeah. Now, I'm a cherry pie guy, and I would say, I don't know exactly what position the pumpkin pie would have, but it would come somewhere after cauliflower. I don't care for the pumpkin.
I'll eat the pumpkin if there's enough whipped cream available.
Yeah, right. As long as you can't taste the pumpkin pie is good. But if I can taste the pumpkin in the pumpkin pie, I'd rather not have it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a lot of peas, and you can hear me popping my peas on the... Yeah, but it is true. It certainly is not my favorite, and I don't know that it's anyone's favorite. It's just one of those things. It's like the candy corn. Mm. Now, I know you like the candy
yes,
corn.
I do.
But you're weird. But no, I don't mean that. I'm just kidding. So it's just like it's obligatory to have the pumpkin pie.
Well, let me ask you this.
Yeah.
Mincemeat pie.
Yeah. Don't care for it, but would still put it in front of pumpkin.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Tim, you like the mincemeat pie?
What is a mincemeat pie?
Well, that answers that question.
Doesn't care for it, has never tried it, and shan't ever
pecan,
try it.
Pecan no, pie. What about pecan
Oh,
pie?
My goodness. Yeah, right up at the
no
top.
Way. No way. I don't
what?
Like nuts.
Rhubarb. You like the rhubarb pie?
Don't care for the rhubarb, which is you'd think I would based on my other choices, Bo. But no, I'm not a rhubarb pie fan. No, not a fan of it.
I prefer strawberry, and I love peanut butter. My mom had a great recipe from the restaurant she used to work at that had peanut butter pie. So every time I eat it, I think of her.
Right now, I'm thinking of George and Martha. I love George and Martha. They're listeners of ours. And Martha right now is pulling her hair out and saying, George, what are they talking about? There's so many big things going on in the world. They're talking about pie. Well, Martha, I only have one question for you.
That's right.
Cherry, apple, or pumpkin?
That's right.
There you go.
Okay, it's welcome to Pie Talk here. Morning Offering. Glad you're going to be here.
I will say apple is better a la mode. I mean, it makes it.
You can eat it by yourself. You can eat it with a group of people. It doesn't matter. come on. We're not splitting hairs here.
Remember that song by Richard Harris, MacArthur Park?
I don't.
MacArthur Park is melting in the dark.
I don't remember.
He left his cake out in the rain.
Oh, I left my cake out in the rain. I know by that song.
One of the weirdest songs of all time. I don't understand
I know
that.
By the other title.
But if you got cake today, you might want to leave it inside unless you want to mimic the song.
Yeah.
Showers today, high near 50, and let's see, looks like between half and three quarters of an inch.
Wow.
Not possible. How do they figure that out?
I don't know, but I want to be the guy out there measuring it. I think we're at a... Okay.
A diminishing chance of showers tonight, about 39, and then mostly cloudy and 44 tomorrow. And then Thanksgiving Day, 46 and sunny. And you have to say it that way.
Yeah, and you got to love that. I mean, right? So that's it. We're heading toward a beautiful Thanksgiving, and what a wonderful time to have it, the perfect timing for all those who are traveling and all that good stuff.
That's right. And perfect pie weather.
Yeah, perfect
Thanksgiving.
Pie. There you go.
Absolutely.
Then that could mean, you know, you could take that and... various different ways. You could think about the food, or you could think about it from a mathematical perspective, or
sure.
But it's perfect no matter what.
Go. Yeah. Let's see. I don't know where we went off the rails, but that's okay.
As soon as we open the mic.
Yeah, that's about the time we usually go off the rails. That's pretty much
kept the expectation right where it needs to be.
But let's see. Dave Vacheresse is in studio. When I call your name, you have to say present.
I. I say I.
He never follows the directions. Yeah. Ron Finn here, and producer Tim is here as well. Tim, how are you?
I'm good.
Well, good.
I was going to say present, but no.
But you can't follow directions.
Simple I never as could.
Well, how about we look at today in history? What do you
Let's
think?
Do it. I like it.
What do you think? Are you ready for this, Tim?
Today all right.
In history.
Tell us all about it, will you?
There's some difficult names in the next selection, but right. This one. 16...
It's like a drum roll.
1620, 41 men from the Mayflower, prior to landing at Plymouth, Massachusetts, signed the Mayflower Compact, by which they agreed to abide by the laws of the new government they would establish. Mm-hmm. 1783, look in the sky. It's a bird. It's a plane. No, it's a hot air balloon. French physician Jean-François Palantre de Rozier and François Lorrain. I made it hard because both were François. Yeah,
or you just say Frank and Frank.
Yeah.
You know, come on.
Made the first untethered hot air balloon flight, flying 5.5 miles over Paris in about 25 minutes.
Talk about bravery.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Yeah, exactly right. And it's like, then they stopped and like, excuse me, we were trying to hang a right somewhere.
So Frank asking says for directions. Frank, what do you think? Should we cut the string or not?
Yeah.
what the heck? We've had a little wine in us.
1877, Thomas Edison announced his invention of the phonograph, a way to record and play back sound. The song he played back was...
Mary Had a Little Lamb.
It was Hey Jude by the Beatles.
Little Lamb.
You have a copy. I should have deleted that, so I could have asked you. That's right. 1995, a peace agreement known as the Dayton Accords, which were signed in Dayton. That's why they call them the Dayton Accords, was reached by the presidents of Bosnia, Croatia, and Serbia, ending the Bosnian War.
Wow.
1995. Celebrity birthdays today. Goldie Hawn, 78. Michael Strahan from Good Morning America and the New York Giants, formerly, is 52. We do some something else for sweets. National Gingerbread Cookies
Don't
Day.
Yeah.
And Red Midden Day.
Okay, Red
but it's not cold enough for Red Middens at this point. But you
not fans of either one of those. But in any case, if you wear red mittens while you're eating the gingerbread, maybe.
Yeah, there you go.
Maybe. Now if you take some of that gingerbread and put that red icing on it, bam, now you got something going on.
At least you got something you can lick off the top.
Yeah, there you go. What else?
There's something else that happened on this date. It was in 1941.
1941.
On this very date that Looney Tunes introduced Tweety Bird for the first time.
Oh.
But now...
You know Tweety Bird.
Yeah,
I thought I drew a pussy cat.
Yeah, Tweety Bird, now known as X.
Yes.
Right? Yeah.
X-Bird.
Yeah, X-Bird. Yeah.
So there's no Twitter. You can't tweet anymore.
I love Tweety Bird.
By the way, the gingerbread cookies, I love... forgive me for saying this. I love just snapping the head of the gingerbread cookie. That's the first place I go. I eat off
That's
the head.
That's a first sign of a troubled childhood.
Yeah, and let me just say this.
Well, it's the biggest part.
When you preface a thing by saying, I hate to say this, you probably ought not say it. Because it means that you're about to say something that you're questioning in your own mind whether you should say or not.
Well, that's true.
And bringing forth this idea of violence that's in your heart regarding gingerbread, it's a little worrisome.
So your question is, whatever the gingerbread man ever do to me?
Well, yeah. And look, we're going to be careful the way we conduct ourselves around you.
Right, yes. Yeah. That does explain one thing, though. I was looking for a stapler, and I looked in Tim's desk drawer, and it's loaded up with gingerbread heads.
Yeah, just the heads.
Big pile of heads
there. Yeah, he's eating the bodies. He's knocking off the heads.
That tastes good, too.
Ooh.
That brain power.
Oh, man. Well, all right. Well, that's a terrific look at today in history.
Today
so thank you very much, Tim.
History.
A little bit off the rails, but that's all right.
That's what we're here for.
Hey, today, big breaking news, and we'll cover this quickly, big breaking news out of Catholic News Agency. I can't say that it came as a surprise, but it has been a while in the coming, and I don't, now I'm trying to find my paper. Here it is. Pope Francis, and this is just the straight news as we pulled it off of Catholic News Agency because it just hit. Pope Francis intervenes in German synodal way, expresses concerns about threats to church unity. He expressed deep reservations about the direction of the Catholic Church in Germany, warning that concrete steps currently being taken threaten to undermine unity with the universal church.
Mm. And in a really kind of an unusual personal intervention, the Pope wrote a letter to four German Catholic laywomen that was published in the German newspaper Welt on November 21st. He says, "I too share concerns about the numerous concrete steps that large parts of this local church are now taking that threaten to move further and further away from the common path of the universal church." So it was written in German and signed Francis.
Yeah, chief among the Pope's concerns is a push to establish a permanent synodal council, a mixed body of laity and bishops that would govern the Catholic Church in Germany. The Pope underscored that this kind of advisory and decision-making body cannot be reconciled with the sacramental structure of the Catholic Church, and referenced a previous prohibition the Vatican had issued on the topic. Leadership of the controversial German Synodal Way recently met in Essen. On November the 10th, they aim to establish a synodal council in Germany no later than 2026. The Pope proposed a different path forward for the church in Germany, and he said this: instead of looking for salvation in ever new committees and always discussing the same topic with a certain self-absorption, the Pope urged the Catholic Church in Germany to open up and go out to meet our brothers and sisters, especially those who are on the thresholds of our church doors, on the streets, in the prisons, in the hospitals, in the squares, in the cities. In other words, and I just kind of sum it up for him, shut up and get to work. You know, look, enough meetings.
I love the way he phrases that, too. Instead of looking for salvation and always discussing the same topic with a certain self-absorption.
Yeah, right.
That encapsulates the whole German synod.
Yeah, instead of looking for salvation in ever new committees. Oh, yeah. My goodness.
Oh, my.
How about that, you know, just talking in circles around each other instead of going out and doing the work. So
amen,
thank you,
brother.
And there's been so much concern about the Synodal Way there in Germany, and people were wondering why Pope Francis had not put an end to some of that conversation. He obviously is at this point, and so we thank him for that, for
amen.
Bringing clarity. And, so thank you.
Absolutely. And in other news, well, I don't know, who am I to say? Wendy knows, though.
Good morning, Wendy.
Thank you, gentlemen, and good morning. In the WTOL 11 newsroom for Annunciation Radio, I'm Wendy Sheridan. After more than 40 days on the picket lines and weeks of voting, the United Auto Workers and Big Three automakers have officially agreed to new contracts. According to the union, across Ford, General Motors, and Stellantis, 64% of voting members said yes to the agreements. Some of the wins for workers include a cost of living adjustment, annual bonuses for retirees, and the elimination of wage tiers. We're learning this morning that a Toledo businessman linked to a city council corruption scheme will spend 2 years on probation. Court documents show Nabil Shaheen took a bribe, then became an FBI informant. Shaheen worked with authorities as they investigated four former council members and an attorney. In Point Place, a woman is facing charges after allegedly pulling someone over while pretending to be a police officer. Court documents state Vita Bennett was driving a black Crown Victoria Police Interceptor last week, which is a vehicle common with police work, and they say she pulled over a woman for an alleged traffic offense. The victim told police she was suspicious and waited for a marked unit to come before getting out of her car. Bennett pleaded not guilty in municipal court and was released. This impersonation charge is a first-degree misdemeanor. Oregon City Council could make a move to increase water rates as early as next week. Council member discussed the proposal last night. They say operating costs are up, and that's the reason they're charging customers more. St. Francis de Sales High School delivers Thanksgiving food baskets to local families this morning. It's the school's annual tradition. For several weeks before the holiday, classes collect food items for baskets. Then a mix of students, faculty, and parents deliver the baskets to predetermined families in need. A night of gun violence in the United States. Four hurt when a shooter opened fire at a Walmart in Beaver Creek, Ohio, before authorities say he killed himself. Also, at least three people were killed and another hurt in a shooting in rural Colorado. There's growing optimism about a potential deal to free the hostages being held in Gaza, mostly women and children. Hamas has been negotiating with Israel through a mediator over a deal that would see the release of some of the more than 200 people taken captive during the terror attack on southern Israel on October 7th. AAA estimates a near record number of Americans, some 55 million, will travel more than 50 miles from their home this year, with a majority of them driving to their Thanksgiving Day destinations. If taking the train, Amtrak's high-speed Acela service between Boston and New York and Washington expects a 25% passenger increase. From the WTOL 11 Weather Center, wet and windy today near 50, clouds tomorrow 45, sunshine returns for Thanksgiving with a high around 50 degrees. In the WTOL 11 newsroom for Annunciation Radio, I'm Wendy Sheridan.
It's Wendy, 43 degrees right now, and a great opportunity for us to really kind of get a little education, get a little reflection going, and it's time for Nonsense this morning. We always look forward to this on Tuesdays, and we always look forward to speaking with Mary, Sister Mary Dolores Gatliff, who served as provincial for our Toledo province for about 8 years, and now is currently at Christ the King. And as we get into Thanksgiving, Sister Mary, how are you this morning?
I am doing well, thank you.
We are thankful.
Even though it's raining hard. It's
We're very thankful that you're with us this morning.
Good morning, well, Sister Mary Dolores.
Good morning. I was reflecting on November, as you asked me to speak today. I just love the month of November. It's such a rich month to reflect on God's goodness. And I'm going to just mention especially three things that come to mind when I think of November highlights.
Wonderful.
The season of fall, first of all. Mm. During November, the peak of those autumn colors happen. Mm. You know, the trees and flowers radiantly sing out their glory to God, and we witness it. I think of Gerard Manley Hopkins' poem, God's Grandeur. You know, that first line, "The world is charged with the grandeur of God." And such beauty, I think, is just a glimpse of the goodness of God in all creation. Amen. And at the end of each day, I ask myself, do I really pause to soak in this beauty and then thank God for it? We can so take it for granted sometimes. The second thing that comes to my mind, especially in November, is that this month begins with two beautiful feasts, All Saints Day and All Souls Day. And celebrating these gives us pause to reflect on the communion of saints. You know, every time we recite the creed, we proclaim that we believe in the Holy Catholic Church and the communion of saints. And that communion includes three groups: all the saints in heaven, whom we remembered on November 1st, all those in purgatory, waiting in hope for their entrance into heaven, those we remembered on November 2nd, and then all of us on earth. We are saints in the making, I would say, still traveling on our journey to God. So as I reflect on the communion of saints, I just think God is so good to give us this hope of everlasting life for all of us. Some family members we know are already in heaven. Maybe some are awaiting heaven in purgatory, but we are also part of that communion of saints.
Amen. And sister, as people gather for Thanksgiving, obviously there's the joy of being with one another, but there's also the sorrow for those who are not with them, not sorrow for them as much as sorrow for us who are missing our loved ones.
That's right. That's right. And often it's stories of the loved ones that come up at Thanksgiving. Mm. And so their spirit is still with us. And that's the third thing that came to my mind when I thought of November and its richness, was this wonderful celebration of Thanksgiving, just 2 days from now already.
Right.
A day set aside to recall in gratitude God's many gifts and blessings. among them family, deceased and living, our friends, and especially our faith, a day for giving thanks. So I would just end by saying, let's take time on Thursday to remember and to give praise to our good God for so many blessings.
Amen. Thank you, Sister Mary Dolores. Now you go to the great banquet of Thanksgiving as you head to Mass. Please keep us in your prayers.
I will do that. Thank you.
Thank you,
Sister. Blessings to all the listeners. Thank you.
And thank happy you so Thanksgiving.
Much. Yes.
Thank you. You too. Bye.
Oh, man, just a great reminder.
Yeah.
There's so much to be thankful for. And there's so often we just dwell on things that take us away from that thankfulness, that attitude of gratitude.
Well, and we have that beautiful word in our Catholic lexicon, Eucharist, which just means Thanksgiving. And so when we boil the whole thing down, I've always said we can never be more generous than God, because God has already given himself in the Eucharist. How can we be more generous than that? And so we can't, but we do get to participate in that, and our own generosity grows through participating in the Eucharist. You become what you eat.
It's one thing I love about Thanksgiving is when, you know, the extended family all gathers around,
yeah.
and then before the meal, we recount individually, going around the table, what are you thankful for? What are you thankful for? What are you thankful for? And it's really neat to see, you know, how these thankful thoughts materialize.
It's beautiful. We tried that at my house once, and 3 out of 4 said, I'm thankful I only have to see you once a year.
Yeah.
And they're like, that's not the purpose of this. And so, no, that's not right. Just kidding.
I love it. All right, let's see. I can't believe we're already closing in on the 8 o'clock hour. I know Dave's going to try to stump us.
Sister Mary Dolores, how fabulous
was
awesome.
That?
Thank
yeah.
you, sister.
Thank you for that wonderful nonsense.
Yeah.
And what else we got going on next hour? Well, all kinds of stuff.
All about Ohio State versus Michigan in our Tuesday trivia
coming.
Today.
Mm-hmm.
That's coming up right after Thanksgiving.
All right. Well, we'll give thanks for that.
That's how they say it in the South. Thanksgiving. Yep. Yep. I'm heading over for Thanksgiving at Mama's house.
Gonna get me some vittles.
Yep.
We'll be right back.
Hello, everyone. This is Bishop Daniel Thomas, the Bishop of the Diocese of Toledo. And I'd like to thank you for listening to Annunciation Radio, Faith with Frequency. May God bless and keep you.
Every weekday afternoon at 3, join us for our live and interactive Divine Mercy Chaplet. Do you have something or someone you're praying for? Imagine the power of hundreds of people praying for your intention. We have several ways for you to share your request. You can visit our app and go to the prayer request button, send an email to chapletprayer@gmail.com, or call our prayer request line at 419-868-2966. Here at Annunciation Radio, we're praying for you.
Underwriting support for Annunciation Radio is provided by Ken's Furniture and Mattress Center in Defiance. Owners Lynn and Sharon Sheets offer furniture for every room in your home by Lazy Boy, England, Serta, Ashley, iComfort, and more. In business for over 50 years, Ken's Furniture is located at 1710 South Jefferson. You may reach them at 800-678-4838. Online at kensfurnitureinc.com.
Living the Beatitudes with Father Bjorn.
Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. We get what we look for. Saint Therese of Lisieux has an interesting insight on this. Once in a discussion over the possibility of avoiding purgatory, the future saint told another member of her community, Sister Maria Febronia, that God was more father than judge. And in this discussion, debate, she finally took the liberty of saying to the other sister, if you look for the justice of God, you will get it. The soul will receive from God exactly what she desires. Are we full of wounds and anger and hurt, and do we want to inflict that on other people? Are we allowing God to heal us? If we receive his mercy, we have to show it to others. The Beatitudes are the heart of Jesus' message. Let's be transformed by them. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy.
EWTN. Live truth. Live Catholic. Catholic Radio for the Diocese of Toledo. This is Annunciation Radio. WNOC Bowling Green Toledo. WHRQ Sandusky. WRRO Eden Bryant. WFOT Lexington Mansfield. And WSHB Willard.
Local, live, and Catholic. Welcome to Morning Offering with Ron and Dave on Annunciation Radio. Here are your hosts, Ron Finn and Dave Vacheresse.
We're back. It's Morning Offering with Ron and Dave. We're so happy that you're with us. We are thrilled that it is a Tuesday. And in fact, this week is flying by because there's only a few days to it. Yeah. And then everybody kind of breaks for Thanksgiving. So,
including us. We won't be here Thursday or Friday.
Right. We will have programming from EWTN to fill in for those holidays, but we ourselves will not be here. We will be with family celebrating Thanksgiving just like many of you will be. Mm-hmm. So we're thankful for that. Hey, it would be remiss if I didn't say again, thank you to everyone who helped us to have such a wonderful, successful share-a-thon last week. We are fully funded for the next 6 months thanks to your generosity.
Amen.
And I can't tell you how much that means to us because if we were not and we had to do, you know, we had to cut out early, say we only had funding for 3 months and then we just went off the air, there would be no Tuesday trivia and that would be sad.
That would be devastating.
That would be sad.
Yes.
If you are ready, gentlemen.
Yeah, I'm ready.
This one's okay, all about Ohio State, Ohio State, Michigan, football in general.
Oh, okay.
Which of these men did not dot the I? Which of these
this would be a tuba player.
Now these are non-band members.
Yeah.
So which of these non-band band members did not dot the I?
My cousin Matt.
As
he was in the band, but didn't dot the I.
Okay. He's not on my list. I don't know Matt. Maybe we can meet him later. I don't know. I'd have no idea where I'm going.
Now,
Did
have to hold a tuba? Did they try to play a tuba? I mean, the I has to be a tuba, right?
No. When a celebrity goes to dot the I, they do not take a tuba with them.
I see.
When was Matt in the band? The squirrel has been introduced.
In the 90s. In the early 90s. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Does he still play? Was he a tuba player?
But he's been invited to the alumni band.
Did he play the tuba?
No, he didn't. So he did not dot.
Why is he disappointed that he didn't get the dot? You don't get to dot the I unless you
play. I was just giving an answer.
I'm confused. All right. Which of these men did not dot the I as a celebrity?
Okay.
I dotter. Which did not? Woody
celebrity
Hayes?
Celebrity I dotter.
Woody Hayes, John Glenn, or Jack Nicklaus? Which of these men did not dot the I? Woody Hayes, John Glenn, Jack Nicklaus, or none of the above.
Wow, this is a
or
a
none of the above.
There are four. I have a theory on this.
Woody Hayes, John Glenn, Jack Nicklaus, or none of the above. So when I say none of the above, that would mean all of them had done it.
I'm going to say Woody Hayes, and the reason being is I just don't believe that he would ever bring himself to that level. He probably didn't think he was worthy enough to do that, so I would say Woody Hayes.
And I'm thinking all of the above because I don't remember Jack Nicholson dotting the I, but...
Jack Nicklaus.
Nicklaus.
The golfer.
Oh, Jack I can see him doing it.
Yeah.
But Nicholson,
Not Nicholson.
Not unless it was at a Lakers game.
He came as Joker. They threw him out.
That's right, yeah.
Woody Hayes, John Glenn, Senator Glenn, or Jack Nicklaus. Which of these did not, or did all of them do it?
Woody Hayes, or did all of them do it?
It's either Woody Hayes or all of the above did it.
I think I'm going to go with all of the above.
Final answer.
Yeah, I guess so.
All of the above is exactly correct.
Wow. Good.
Woody Hayes, to your point, was very humbled by the opportunity to go in and dot the I. Senator John Glenn, of course, and Jack Nicklaus, a great lover of the Ohio State University, where he played golf. And so there you go.
A golden bear.
Very nice.
And then the next question. So that's one for one. How many, and I have to pronounce it the way that I've spelled it, because once you put it on the paper, you have to do it.
That's
true. It's the script. How many times has the Ohio State game pitted the number one team, the Ohio State versus Michigan game, pitted the number one team in the land versus the number two team in the land? How many times has the vaulted Ohio State Buckeyes and Michigan Wolverines getting together at the end of the year, how many times have they been sitting in that number one and number two position as they entered that game? Is it one, three, or five times?
I'm saying
you're thinking one.
Yes.
I'm thinking one also.
And I think it was 2006.
Wow. And, you know, I feel that's correct. Okay. I'm going to go with Tim on that. Final answer, one.
One. That's your final answer?
Yeah. Well, his mouse is a buzzer.
Yeah, that's your final?
Yes.
Okay.
It is.
Very good. Nicely done. Just one time.
Trying to deceive
you. Very good. Not only that. Now this one you've got a 50-50 chance at. Like, you know, hindsight's 50-50. This is a 50-50 chance.
Okay.
True or false. In 2022, so last season, Ohio State had more players on NFL rosters than any other college. True or false?
Boy, oh boy, that could be true.
Wow.
In 2022, last season, Ohio State had more players on active NFL rosters on the sidelines, not on practice squads, on the sidelines than any other college.
Well, if there's not practice squad players, that changes my answer entirely.
Right. No, I'm talking about on rosters, on sidelines, had more on the rosters than any other college football team, period, in last season.
Well,
I'm thinking it's plausible, but my gut's telling me that's false.
Well,
there's some big
here's my thing. If it's true, you know that Dave would put it out there because it would be true because, you know, his
bragging
being
rights.
Such a lover for Ohio State. However, I would think Alabama would probably have more. So I'm going to defer to you on that. I know I gave a two-way answer, but
you gave no answer whatsoever.
I'm sitting on the fence.
You talked around the whole thing.
Oh,
it's just true or false. Like, what is it?
Yeah, sometimes you reason it out. Good. Sometimes you just stall.
Yeah, right. Is it true or false?
I'm thinking it is false.
You think it's false?
I think it's plausible, but I think it's false.
And that's true. That no, you're right.
Oh, good.
That it's false, but it's barely false.
Mm. Yeah.
Here is the fact. There was no team in college football that had more players on an NFL roster than Ohio State. Hmm. That statement is true.
Hmm.
Not a single team in college football had more players on the rosters, NFL rosters, than Ohio State because Ohio State tied with another team. And it was not Alabama. Now think about it. Who might that be if Ohio, in 2022?
Mm-hmm.
Ohio State tied for the most players on an NFL roster, 52, by the way, 52 players on NFL rosters, active NFL rosters last year. Who tied with them?
Texas?
No.
Some California school?
Nope.
No.
Notre Dame?
Nope. LSU.
Oh.
LSU.
No, I figured it was an SEC.
Ohio State and LSU both had 52.
That makes sense.
Now, you went 3-0, so you really don't need the bonus, but I am going to give you one anyway because I'm generous.
You said that there was no bonus.
I know, but I've come up with it.
That's why we tried so hard to get them right.
Yeah, I know.
You're 3-0. You don't need the bonus.
I've been deceived.
You don't need the bonus. Carry over to next Tuesday.
Here's the bonus. But that's fine. Here's the bonus. And no fudging on this. So here we go.
So no fence traveling.
It's easy enough to know. I am thinking of a number between 1 and 3. Whole numbers only.
Mm-hmm.
1, 2, or 3. Which number am I thinking of, Mr. Finn?
17.
Nope.
You do this all the time. I'm not going to get it right. 2.
2. Now go back.
Because it's between 1 and 3.
So, no. 2 is wrong.
Yeah.
Not by your wording.
So it's 1
it's
or
definitely
three.
1.
Yeah.
Or 3.
You're right.
It was 1.
You, by the wording, you said, I'm thinking of a number between 1 and 3. Well, if it's a whole number, it's 2. Your wording needs to be right. Because
Tim, you are correct, but you have to keep this principle in mind. You're an employee. He's the boss.
Hey, you have to keep the principle of annoying in mind. Don't be so particular. No, there you go. It was the correct answer was 1, although from a reasoned out point of view, your answer was also right.
Mm-hmm.
So there you go. You guys got bonuses and they got everything right. You literally got nothing wrong.
I am thankful.
In today's Tuesday trivia. So very nicely done. Congratulations to both of you on probably, honestly, the best Tuesday trivia ever. And some of that was not easy.
That's true.
I mean, look, I don't know how many people would think that big game between Ohio State and Michigan has only pitted 1 versus 2 one time, ever.
That is amazing.
Yeah, and remember that game. Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
Oh, did they? That was game. Overtime when, or just barely well, didn't go into overtime.
Now, as we head into this weekend's game, is it, let's see, Ohio State, are they one or two?
Ohio right State now. Is sitting at two, and Michigan two, is because they're going to use three.
So they're three.
Yeah, they're going to use the
football playoff.
Yeah,
rankings.
Football playoff yes. rankings. Gotcha. And we're two, okay. and they're three. So
good. Should and be good. Big plans for watching the game and maybe tailgating. Are you going to have a big tailgate party?
I've been practicing this. I'm going to watch the game with eyes open.
Well, that would be
that's
helpful.
A good idea.
Dave.
I'm just trying. Because I will be honest with you, most games, they don't stay open the whole time. Like, I mm-hmm. watch a quarter and I'm asleep, honestly. I mean, I find football exhilarating and exciting in pieces, mm-hmm. not usually in whole games. But mm-hmm. but Ohio State, Michigan, I watch the entirety of it.
Do you wear your jersey when you watch the game?
I never played for Ohio State. I mean, I know your cousin was in the band.
Yeah.
But I don't have, like, I didn't play for them.
So you don't have like a jersey that says Vacheresse on the back of it or
no,
something like that?
No, okay. I do, but it's from Pee Wee, and it's a horrible memory, by and the way.
I don't think you could fit in that now.
Yeah. Pee Wee football, fourth grade. That was the highlight of my football career, and it was mostly on the bench.
Oh, wow.
There you go.
Very
That's
good.
A good place to be.
Then they put me out there. Now, this true story. Quickly. I'll tell it quickly. I promise. Well, yeah, I'll tell it quickly.
Why would you want to do that?
So in my hometown, fourth, fifth, and sixth graders played in peewee football together, mm-hmm. right? Because you had to have enough people.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Mm.
So my elder brother, Joe, who was a star athlete and just absolutely fabulous, and fabulously athletic, and I was not. He was in the sixth grade, the elder group, mm-hmm. and I was in the fourth grade. And not very athletic and not very likable either. But in any case.
I find that hard to believe.
And my father always drilled it into our heads. Family of seven. If anybody messes with any of you, the other ones better come to their rescue. Mm. That was it. Mm-hmm. Like you never let somebody pick on a younger sibling. You go forward. You protect your family. Literally at all costs. Mm-hmm. Kind of like the mafia, bro. But not really. But in a big Catholic family. So also that principle. So I get into a game finally, and a player comes and a sixth grader comes and really smacks me hard, knocks me to the ground, and I'm probably weeping like a child. But in any case, I was hit hard. My brother, who's on the sidelines now because he had scored 8 touchdowns to get us far enough ahead so I could play for 30 seconds, runs onto the field, tackles the guy, and starts beating him up.
Oh, my.
And my father came out and said, not in this situation, Joe.
Yeah.
He's allowed to hit him out here. That's not what I was talking about.
Is that true?
That's absolutely true.
Oh, my goodness.
Absolutely true. My brother said, you're not allowed to hit my little brother. Like, oh, yeah, it's a game. It's a game, Joe. It's okay.
Wow.
But he's crying, Daddy. Daddy said, he's always crying, Joe. It's okay. He's a big baby. No,
just
he
remember,
didn't say that.
There's
never
no
said
crying
that.
In football.
No crying in football.
That's right, yes.
Anyway, there you go.
Wow, that's a great story.
Yeah.
I like that.
Love my brother Joe. Always there to protect me. Good stuff.
Hey, let's pray, shall we?
Let's pray.
My God, I adore you, and I love you with all my heart. I thank you for having created me, made me a Christian, and preserved me this night. I offer you the actions of this day. Grant that all of them may be in accordance with your holy will, and for your greater glory. Protect me from sin and from all evil. Let your grace be always with me and with all my dear ones. Amen.
Amen. Thank Amen. You, Carolyn. We continue our prayer as we encourage you to join Parents of Priests and Annunciation Radio as we pray for our clergy and religious. We pray for vocations and for an increase of faith so as to become a more holy diocese of Toledo. Today we pray for Reverend Jonathan White.
Dear Lord, we pray that the Blessed Mother wrap her mantle around your priest to follow her own words. Do whatever he tells you. May your priest have the heart of St. Joseph, Mary's most chaste spouse. May the Blessed Mother's own pierced heart inspire them to embrace all who suffer at the foot of the cross. May your priest be wholly filled with the fire of your love, seeking nothing but your greater glory and the salvation of souls. Amen. St. John Vianney,
pray for us.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. And we add Hail Mary for an increase of vocations here in the Diocese of Toledo. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. And our word for today on this memorial of the presentation of the Blessed Virgin Mary on this Tuesday, November the 21st, our word for today is lost. Lost is our word for today. Our reading from the second book of Maccabees, chapter 6. Eleazar, one of the foremost scribes, a man of advanced age and noble appearance, was being forced to open his mouth to eat pork. But preferring a glorious death to a life of defilement, he spat out the meat and went forward of his own accord to the instrument of torture, as people ought to do who have the courage to reject the food which is unlawful to eat, even for love of life. Those in charge of that unlawful ritual meal took the man aside privately because of their long acquaintance with him and urged him to bring meat of his own, providing such as he could legitimately eat, and to pretend to be eating some of the meat of the sacrifice prescribed by the king. In this way he would escape the death penalty and be treated kindly because of their old friendship with him. But Eleazar made up his mind in a noble manner worthy of his years, the dignity of his advanced age, the merited distinction of his gray hair, and of the admirable life he had lived from childhood. And so he declared that, above all, he would be loyal to the holy laws given by God. He told them to send him at once to the abode of the dead, explaining, "At our age, it would be unbecoming to make such a pretense. Many young people would think the 90-year-old Eleazar had gone over to an alien religion. Should I thus pretend for the sake of a brief moment of life, they would be led astray by me, while I would bring shame and dishonor on my old age. Even if, for the time being, I avoid the punishment of men, I shall never, whether alive or dead, escape the hands of the Almighty. Therefore, by manfully giving up my life now, I will prove myself worthy of my old age, and I will leave to the young a noble example of how to die willingly and generously for the revered and holy laws." Eleazar spoke thus and went immediately to the instrument of torture. Those who shortly before had been kindly disposed now became hostile toward him, because what he had said seemed to them utter madness. When he was about to die under the blows, he groaned and said, "The Lord in his holy knowledge knows full well that, although I could have escaped death, I am not only enduring terrible pain in my body from this scourging, but also suffering it with joy in my soul because of my devotion to him." This is how he died, leaving in his death a model of courage and an unforgettable example of virtue, not only for the young, but for the whole nation. Our responsorial psalm, Psalm number 3, "The Lord upholds me. O Lord, how many are my adversaries! Many rise up against me, many are saying of me, 'There is no salvation for him in God.' But you, O Lord, are my shield, my glory, you lift up my head. When I call out to the Lord, he answers me from his holy mountain. When I lie down and sleep, I wake again, for the Lord sustains me. I fear not the myriads of people arrayed against me on every side."
Alleluia, alleluia. God so loved us and sent his Son as expiation for our sins. Alleluia, alleluia. Our Holy Gospel from Luke chapter 19. At that time, Jesus came to Jericho and intended to pass through town. Now a man there named Zacchaeus, who was chief tax collector and also a wealthy man, was seeking to see who Jesus was, but he could not see because of the crowd, for he was short in stature. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore tree in order to see Jesus, who was about to pass that way. When he reached that place, Jesus looked up and said, "Zacchaeus, come down quickly, for today I must stay at your house." And he came down quickly and received him with joy. When they saw this, they began to grumble, saying, "He has gone to stay at the house of a sinner." But Zacchaeus stood there and said to the Lord, Behold, half of my possessions, Lord, I shall give to the poor, and if I have extorted anything from anyone, I shall repay it four times over. And Jesus said to him, Today salvation has come to this house, because this man too is a descendant of Abraham. For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save what was lost.
Lost, our word for today. Our Holy Father's thoughts regarding today's gospel reading, these he shared during his Angelus address on June the 10th, 2018. Today's gospel reading shows us two types of misunderstanding that Jesus had to face, that of the scribes and that of his own brethren. They were worried because his new itinerant life seemed like folly to them. In fact, he exhibited such openness toward the people, especially toward the sick and toward sinners, to the extent that he did not even have time to eat. Jesus was like that. People first, serving people, helping people, teaching people, healing people. He was for the people. He did not even have time to eat. Thus his brethren decided to take him back home to Nazareth. His brethren came to the place where Jesus was teaching, and they sent to him and called him. He was told, Your mother and your brothers are outside asking for you. And he replied, Who are my mother and my brethren? And looking around on those who sat about him, he said, Here are my mother and my brethren. Whoever does the will of God is my brother, sister, and mother. Jesus formed a new family, no longer based on natural ties, but on faith in him, on his love which welcomes us and unites us to each other in the Holy Spirit. All those who welcome Jesus' word are children of God and brothers and sisters among themselves. Welcoming the word of Jesus makes us brothers and sisters, makes us Jesus' family. Speaking ill of others, destroying others' reputations, makes us the devil's family. Jesus' response was not a lack of respect for his mother and his brethren. Rather, for Mary, it is the greatest recognition, precisely because she herself is the perfect disciple who completely obeyed God's will. May the Virgin Mary help us to live always in communion with Jesus, recognizing the work of the Holy Spirit who acts in him and in the church, regenerating the world to a new life. Lost, our word for today. This reading from 2 Maccabees, one, let me just say, it pains my heart and pains the heart of the Spirit, I believe as well, that there isn't a access to the first and second book of Maccabees for the entire body of Christ. It has been excised, and so people miss out on some of this beauty, this wonderful testimony that is in the first and second book of Maccabees. And in particular, now we're talking about Eleazar. He's 90 years old, and he's brought to the place of worship for the pagans, and he's told to eat this meat sacrificed to the false gods. And he says, no, I'm not going to do it. And they said, just pretend, bring your own meat and act like it's the meat sacrificed to the gods. That way you are doing what you need to do as prescribed by the law, but you're also being able to satisfy your own conscience. And he says, absolutely not. I live an authentic life for God. I'm not going to let someone else see me do something, assume I'm doing the thing that I'm not doing, because it will ruin my testimony. And it might lead someone else astray. St. Paul says it a different way. He says, all things are right for me, but I avoid doing some of them because in doing it, it causes others to stumble. So I just don't do it because it's not in their best interest. Not because it's not in my best interest. I'm allowed to do it. But I do it not because it's not good for them. So that is being others-centered, right? That is ministering to the lost, those who might be overly scrupulous. That might set them in a wrong direction. And Eleazar points to this. I need to be a model to the younger generation to be faithful to the Lord even unto death. And trickery is not going to get me anywhere because it might fool the people in front of me, but it won't fool my God. And I won't escape his hands, and I would rather be in his hands than yours. And what does he say at the end? Oh, my goodness. I love this. One, after he had denied their invitation, their kindness, honestly, and their own way of thinking, right? In their own confused way of thinking, they were trying to be kind to him because of their affection for him. And it says, those who shortly before had been so kindly disposed now became hostile toward him because what he had said seemed to them utter madness. Does that smack familiar? People are kind until we have to stand up for the truth. And they'll say, you know, well, what do you think about this? And you say, now you're asking me what I think about it, right? So I'm going to tell you what I think about it. I didn't put this on you. I didn't go after you. I wasn't unkind to you. But now you're asking me to reveal how I think about it. I think about it the way the Lord thinks about it. And for me, there's no compromise on that thing. And then anger explodes and people become frustrated and downright violent when we will not succumb to what the world says. Violence comes forward. As long as we will keep our mouths shut and be off to ourselves and say, this only exists inside the church, you do what you want. That works for a time. Then they come for the church and say, you know what, church, you have to agree with us too. And the church says, no, we cannot. It's impossible for us to agree with you. It's not impossible for us to love you. We love you. We want salvation for you, but we cannot agree with you. And then violence comes forward because it's not just an idea of letting people live the way they want to live. You have to also believe it. You have to affirm them in that lifestyle. And that we cannot do. Eleazar could not do it. We cannot do it. And when we are willing to stand up even at the loss of our own lives, we minister to those who are truly lost, those who are hanging out in the trees. And brothers and sisters, they are hanging out in the trees. Zacchaeus needed to see Jesus. He wanted to see if he was actually authentic. And Jesus turned to him with love and said, I love you, Zacchaeus. Let me come to your home. And that began this beautiful conversion of Zacchaeus. They're hanging out in the trees of our lives too, looking to see if we are authentic. Yes, are we willing to lay down our lives in service of the Lord? They're looking for that. But in the midst of it, they're looking to see if we love them anyway. If when we look at them in the tree, are we judging them for where they stand now? Or are we seeing them as made in the image and likeness of God? And the fact that God desires to be in right relationship with them. Can we first turn to them with love? And then, as it happened with Zacchaeus, Jesus didn't look at him in the tree and say, unless you repent, Zacchaeus, I will not come to your home. Zacchaeus repented because he met the Lord. And in meeting the Lord, that repentance came forward by his own confession. So we first introduce ourselves, love the person that is in that tree, waiting to be loved, waiting to be accepted, waiting to be invited. And then the Lord does that work in their hearts of conversion, maybe all at once, maybe in small pieces. But that, brothers and sisters, is the work of the Lord as we minister to the lost. Lost, our word for today.
Great word. Great lesson in today's readings as well.
Eleazar. I mean, I just want to know the guy. I can't wait to meet
exactly.
him. I mean, 90 years old, and he's, and he walks himself to the torture chamber. He's like, no, I'm done. Let's go. Let's go do this. And no, I wanted to say this one thing. This is the one thing he said. I love this. When he's being tortured, he said, the Lord in his holy knowledge knows full well that although I could have escaped death, I am not only enduring the terrible pain in my body from the scourging, but also suffering it with joy in my soul, with joy in my soul because of my devotion to him. He was joyful in the midst of the torture.
Our hero.
Ooh, gotta love it. Love you, Eleazar. Can't wait to meet you.
Thank you, Dave. And, of course, coming up a little later, well, Kendra Von Esch will weigh in on the word of the day. Sooner than that, we're going to find out a sports update from Father Matt Frisbee. But right now, Wendy Sheridan with the latest news.
Thank you, gentlemen, and good morning. In the WTOL 11 newsroom for Annunciation Radio, I'm Wendy Sheridan. After more than 40 days on the picket lines and weeks of voting, the United Auto Workers and Big Three automakers have officially agreed to new contracts.
According to the union, across Ford, General Motors, and Stellantis, 64% of voting members said yes to the agreements. Some of the wins for workers include a cost of living adjustment, annual bonuses for retirees, and the elimination of wage tiers. We're learning this morning that a Toledo businessman linked to a city council corruption scheme will spend 2 years on probation. Court documents show Nabil Shaheen took a bribe, then became an FBI informant. Shaheen worked with authorities as they investigated four former council members and an attorney. In Point Place, a woman is facing charges after allegedly pulling someone over while pretending to be a police officer. Court documents state Vita Bennett was driving a black Crown Victoria Police Interceptor last week, which is a vehicle common with police work, and they say she pulled over a woman for an alleged traffic offense. The victim told police she was suspicious and waited for a marked unit to come before getting out of her car. Bennett pleaded not guilty in municipal court and was released. This impersonation charge is a first-degree misdemeanor. Oregon City Council could make a move to increase water rates as early as next week. Council member discussed the proposal last night. They say operating costs are up, and that's the reason they're charging customers more. St. Francis de Sales High School delivers Thanksgiving food baskets to local families this morning. It's the school's annual tradition. For several weeks before the holiday, classes collect food items for baskets. Then a mix of students, faculty, and parents deliver the baskets to predetermined families in need. A night of gun violence in the United States. Four hurt when a shooter opened fire at a Walmart in Beaver Creek, Ohio, before authorities say he killed himself. Also, at least three people were killed and another hurt in a shooting in rural Colorado. There's growing optimism about a potential deal to free the hostages being held in Gaza, mostly women and children. Hamas has been negotiating with Israel through a mediator over a deal that would see the release of some of the more than 200 people taken captive during the terror attack on the southern Israel on October 7th. AAA estimates a near-record number of Americans, some 55 million, will travel more than 50 miles from their home this year.
Thank you very much, Wendy. We appreciate that. Yes, indeed, it is time right about now. It's time for a sports roundup. Hey, you know what? Father Matt Frisbee is standing by. Morning, Father.
Good morning, Dave and Ron. Good to be with you. A lot to talk about. We are in the heart of football season, and I think it's good, firstly, we all know what's happening this upcoming Saturday. We all know what happened this past Sunday. We'll talk about those, but I think maybe it's good to talk about what's upcoming this Friday, as we have three area high school football teams playing in their respective divisions, state semifinals, the Final Four. Division Three, my alma mater, Central Catholic, is playing Chardon. Mm-hmm. And then we have, in Division Five, it is Liberty Center. I don't remember who they're playing, but they've been a pretty dominant team as well. And then in Division Seven, Patrick Henry had that big, thrilling win over Macomb and in Division Seven. And for their efforts and for their victory, Patrick Henry gets to play Maria Stein, Marion Local, who's on like a 50-game win streak or something like that. So,
It's going to be pretty exciting and a lot of traveling going on. Where's the Central game?
That is Elyria, I believe.
Okay, and I know Liberty Center is playing in Sydney, Ohio. So,
they get to
go to stadiums they probably haven't been in before.
That's right. So, but it's a. Just a congratulations, because certainly as we're here, it's week 15 in the season. And of course, for teams, that's one of those goals. You want to practice on Thanksgiving morning. You don't, but you do. And for Central Catholic and Liberty Center and Patrick Henry, that's what they get to do this year. So congratulations. And hopefully they all get a win and go on to the state final game.
So that's it. We're just one win away from going to the state final.
That's right.
Isn't that fabulous? Right.
Yes, it is. So, but we'll move on. Let's start with what we saw on Sunday. The Browns beat the Steelers. This is the first ever the Browns have beaten the Ravens and Steelers in consecutive weeks. And then the other thing about the Browns' victory, which was an ugly victory, but we'll take it. You know, you have to win. Good teams win games. But the other noteworthy things were this, that they introduced and we saw Nick Chubb walk out onto the field briefly, you know, when they were introducing the lineup. And then also the return of Jim Donovan, the Browns radio play-by-play man who's been battling leukemia. He was out for he called week one against the Bengals. He was out. Now he's back after treatment. So that's good news. Mm-hmm. All of that really gets Browns fans fired up. And they go out to Denver, which will be a tough game this week.
Yeah, and the quarterbacks continue to fall throughout the NFL. Deshaun Watson, of course, out for the season. Now Joe Burrow out for the season. The whole thing about NFL is you got to keep your team intact as much as possible.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Last week when we talked, of course, it was the Share-a-thon. We were all excited about the Browns. The very next day after we talked, Deshaun Watson out for the season, and then we saw Thursday night, Joe Burrow out. And the Browns, tons of injuries this year, tons of them.
Yeah.
But that's the thing, and this is the important thing, building depth, having guys that can kind of step in, and, you know, that defense for the Browns is going to help them out in a lot of games. The Lions, we should note, too, they come from behind to win. You know, they were down a bunch and did not look good, but they found a way as well win that game at the end. And of course, as always, we'll see them on Thanksgiving Day around 12:30 or so playing the Packers.
Yeah, and last night Philly overcame Kansas City. Kansas City a couple of opportunities to win that at the end of the game, and nobody could catch a ball for Patrick Mahomes.
That's right. At Arrowhead.
Yeah.
That's always a tough place to play.
I mean, now, Philly has one loss on the season.
Yeah. Again, you know, you just don't always play your best, but you find ways to win. That's the name of the game, really.
Yeah.
Now we got to move on Saturday.
And then, real quickly, the NBA. Okay, that's enough of that. All right, so, yeah, big-time football stuff going on. Can't wait for this weekend. Any predictions score-wise, Father?
No, I have no predictions. And if you force me to give one, I'm not going to give one. Because I think this is really a very good game. You know, I think we see Ohio State, albeit their opponents last week, not the strongest, but I think we've seen them incrementally get better each week. And that's what you want to do with your season. Michigan, much like last year, you know, the week before the Ohio State game, Michigan did not look great against Illinois last year. They didn't look great against Maryland last week. Maryland's a pretty good opponent. I mean, they're not world beaters, but they're a pretty good opponent. So we'll find out. You know, I think J.J. McCarthy early in the year had a lot of hype behind him, and he's looked pretty mortal the last couple weeks. And I think Ohio State can force J.J. McCarthy to stay in the pocket and have to read the entire field more than one read. Ohio State might be able to do stuff, but they got to be able to move the ball too. I mean, I think two very, very good defenses. And, you know, obviously whoever scores more points wins.
Yeah, right. I don't know if you saw the warning come out from the Columbus Police Department. They said, even though the game is in the Big House, watch all the signs in Columbus because the Michigan fans are frustrated and they want to steal signs, but they've been busted. So watch the stop signs, watch the yield signs. They're just in a place where they're the yard signs doesn't matter. They want to pick up a sign or two.
Oh my! Well, Father, we're really thankful for your insights into the world of sports. I'd be lost without you. So thank you so much and happy Thanksgiving.
Yes, happy Thanksgiving to you too. You, Ron and Dave and Tim and all our listeners. Really a wonderful day, but also an opportunity for us just to kind of step back and to recognize all the blessings in our life and that life is probably a lot better than we actually realize at times, you know. And we think about what our forefathers and foremothers had to go through and
how life was probably a lot more difficult for them in some ways, and recognize we're pretty blessed here, and thank God for that, and especially the people in their life more than anything.
Amen. Thanks for putting that in perspective.
Yeah, absolutely. And remember, even if Ohio State loses for the third time this coming weekend in a row, the sun will still come up. I won't, but the sun will come up, and life will go on.
That's exactly right. You know, we'll get up, we'll put our pants on one leg at a time the next day, and life will go on.
I might need a week, but we'll see. We'll get through it.
One leg at a time. That's what I've been doing wrong.
That's it.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Father Matt.
Thank you. God bless.
Who is that dot in the eye? I'm looking. I can't.
It's Jack Nicklaus.
Nicholson?
It's Woody Hayes. It's not Jack Nicholson. It's Senator John Glenn. I don't know who the
you
other
know
celebrities
what?
Are.
Life isn't fair. God isn't fair. Fairness would be if he let us go to hell because he made us for himself, we rejected him, and we got what we deserved. Fairness would be if there was no hope for heaven, no forgiveness. That would be fair. That would be just. Fairness in your life would be if someone offends you and you hold it over their heads for the rest of their lives and never forget it and never move on. Fairness would be when you judge people and you write them off based on a comment they made or who they voted for because you got them entirely figured out. You pegged them. Fairness makes us miserable. The central image of our faith is a man dying on a cross who is completely innocent for your sins. The central image of our faith, thank God, isn't fairness, it's mercy. And that's who God is calling you to be merciful just as he is merciful. Send us a message at connect@reallifecatholic.com. This is Chris Stefanik from reallifecatholic.com.
Well, okay, thank you, Chris. I don't know where our music went, but it disappeared. Hey, we are back here, morning offering on this Tuesday. Yeah, and coming up, Kendra Von Esch with our word of the day.
Yeah, straight can't
ahead.
Wait for that.
We've got Heroes of the Tuesday. Faith straight ahead as well.
Yeah, and I got a little, I bet you didn't know that. I know I didn't.
Good.
Ready for today. Here we go. You typically only breathe out of one nostril at a time.
Really?
Try that. Try to breathe out of both.
I can't seem to control that.
You might think that your nostrils share the workload when it comes to taking in oxygen, and while they do, it's not quite in the way that you might expect. Instead of both taking in the same amount of air when you breathe, you actually inhale most of your oxygen through one nostril at a time. Every few hours, the active nostril will take a break, and the other one will take over until they ultimately switch back again. May indicate why some people have trouble breathing with the head cold. Now, here's the thing.
That is interesting, because now that I'm aware of this, it seems like my left nostril is doing most of the work right now. And you say later it'll switch?
It'll switch unless, and you've got to pay close attention to this. There might be a little argument going on because it might be the right nostril saying, man, I did my four-hour shift, you lazy bum. Get up. Because I kind of think about it like a tandem driving a truck across the country, a semi-truck.
Sure.
One is driving, one is sleeping. Mm-hmm. But if Eddie is lazy and it's time to get up, then Jimmy's driving the whole way.
Yeah.
And I don't think it's fair to Jimmy. And I don't
agree.
Know if Jimmy's the right nostril or the left, but let's just be careful out there.
Yeah.
Giraffes hum to each other at night to make sure their herd stays together.
Really?
Yeah. And not the herd, H-E-A-R-D. Their H-E-R-D, their herd, their group. Although scientists had previously believed that the giraffes were either completely silent or made noises that humans were unable to hear, they learned that they can hum, and humans can hear it too. Hmm. In 2015, researchers from the University of Vienna gathered 947 hours of giraffe noises over an 8-year period. Oh, my goodness. How about that
wow.
project? Well, I just got my master's degree. I got my doctorate listening to giraffes hum at three zoos and discovered that the animals produced a humming sound at night. The scientists hypothesized that the animals do this to help keep their herd together when their vision is impaired in the low light.
Hmm.
There you go.
Interesting.
That's what's keeping the folks at the University of Vienna busy.
Yeah.
There's a little, I bet you didn't know that. I know I didn't. And now for...
Yeah, we can do Heroes of the Faith, sure.
After the music.
We found our music, by the way.
There's the music.
Yeah, we found it.
Thank you.
But yeah, our Heroes of the Faith today. Oh, I love that. That always sets it up so nicely.
It does. It's perfect.
Blessed Ludovico
I'm looking at it.
Morbioli.
Mm.
Okay. Ludovico Morbioli.
I want to order that at an Italian
restaurant. I bet that's delicious. Yeah. And he was one of six children born to the lower middle class family of Francesco Antonio and Agnes Morbioli. Ludovico spent his early adult life in a dissolute life that included gambling, violence, and a lot of heavy drinking. So he married to Lucia Tura, and while living in Venice, Italy in 1462, Ludovico was struck with a serious but unspecified illness. They didn't know what it was, but it was very serious, and it was cared for, or he was, at the hospice run by the canons regular of St. Savior. Now, this brush with death led him to re-examine his life and also to a conversion experience, as well as a determination to do penance for his earlier life. And from then that point on, he wandered the streets preaching penance and living in complete poverty. He carried a staff with a crucifix and always a plain gray shirt or white shirt with a cross on the chest, which led many to associate him with the Carmelites, though he was never a member of any religious order. Now, Ludovico returned to Bologna, Italy in 1470 and continued his life as a street preacher there. He wandered through Modena and Ferrara, Italy, preaching. People would gather around him to mock him, as he looked like a wild man. He had wild hair, unkempt beard, but then his preaching would keep them listening. He finally returned to Bologna and spent his remaining time in the basement of Palazzo Lupari, which he fitted out like a monk's cell. It was later converted into an oratory. Blessed John Baptist Spagnuolo wrote a poem about his life. So, kind of talk about turning on a dime, you know what I'm saying? It's kind of an interesting life for this guy. He was died in 1485. And his relics have since been lost, but he was beatified on October 24th, 1843, by Pope Gregory the 16th. So, yeah, blessed Ludovico Morbioli, our hero of the faith today. Yes, pray for us indeed.
You love this, that it's a crisis, and it often is, right? And so what looks to be just a horrible event, a horrible change of circumstances, is actually the thing that leads him to turn his face to the Lord. Yeah. And so it's hard to see that as anything other than a blessing once you see what the result of it was.
Absolutely.
Don't always know that ahead of time, but often the Lord uses things like that to draw us closer to him.
And it gives us someone that many of us can relate to.
I mean, amen. Yeah.
There you go. It's our hero of the faith today, and our heroine of word of the day is coming up in just a few moments. Yes, you know who I'm talking about, don't you?
It's the one, the only Kinder Von Esch.
Welcome to Catechism for Today with Father Nicholas Weibel. Lessons for daily life from the Catechism of the Catholic Church.
Two men once visited a holy man to ask his advice. "We have done wrong actions," they said. "Our consciences are troubled. What must we do to be forgiven?" "Tell me of your wrongdoing, my son," said the old man. First man said, "I committed a great and grievous sin." "I've done a number of wrong things," said the second man, "but they're all quite small, not all important." "Go," said the holy man, "and bring me a stone for each misdeed." The first man staggered back with an enormous boulder. Second cheerfully brought a bag of small pebbles. "Now," said the holy man, "go and put them back where you found them." The first man shouldered his great rock again, staggered back to the place from which he had brought it. But the second man could only remember where a few of his pebbles had lain. He came back saying that the task was too difficult. "Sins are like stones," said the old man. "If a man has committed a great sin, it lies like a heavy stone on his conscience. Yet if he feels truly sorry, he is forgiven, the load of guilt is taken away. But if a man is constantly doing small things that he knows to be wrong, he does not feel any great load of guilt, so he is not sorry, remains a sinner. So you see, my sons, it is as important to avoid little sins as big ones." What does the Catechism say about that? Paragraph 1863. "Venial sin weakens charity. It manifests a disordered affection for created goods. It impedes the soul's progress in the exercise of the virtues and the practice of the moral good. It merits temporal punishment. Deliberate and unrepentant venial sin disposes us little by little to commit mortal sin. However, venial sin does not break the covenant with God. With God's grace, it is humanly repairable. venial sin does not deprive the sinner of sanctifying grace, friendship with God, charity, and consequently eternal happiness. If today you hear his voice, harden not your hearts.
Local, live, and Catholic. Welcome to Morning Offering with Ron and Dave on Annunciation Radio. Here are your hosts, Ron Finn and Dave Vacheresse.
And we are back. It's Morning Offering with Ron and Dave. Kendra Von Esch coming up in just a couple of minutes. But before that, Mr. Finn, what's going on?
Well, I'll tell you what's going on. This is going to be just a wonderful time of year for some very special events, like from Saturday, November 25th, all the way through the 29th, you can explore the miraculous through an extraordinary Eucharistic miracles exhibition. Mm. This is going to be at St. Rose Perrysburg. It's going to be in the lower level of the church, and the exhibit hours are Saturday the 25th from 6 to 7:30 p.m., and then Sunday the 26th after all masses until 7:30 p.m., and then they will have that exhibit open from 10 to 9, November 27th and 28th, and on the 29th from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m.
Nice.
So this is going to be a wonderful thing. And then Friday, December 1st, St. Augustine Christmas House at St. Augustine Napoleon on Monroe Street in Napoleon. That's all day long on Friday, December 1st. Also on Friday, December 1st, the Seven Saints Knights of Columbus serving a perch or shrimp dinner at the KFC Hall on Hayman Drive in Attica. That's from 4 to 6:30 p.m. St. Mary's Tiffin is presenting The Eucharist Can Change Your Life, a special Advent evening of reflection with guest speaker Andrew Reinhardt at the Parish Life, and he's the Parish Life Coordinator for the Diocese of Toledo, but he'll be presenting at St. Mary's Catholic Church on South Sandusky Street in Tiffin. This is coming up on Saturday, December 2nd from, 7 to 9 p.m. And then mark this on your calendar, too, on Monday, December 4th, pray for all our priests serving in the Diocese of Toledo as they gather for the annual Day of Prayer for the Sanctification of Priests at the Basilica and National Shrine of Our Lady of Consolation. That's, again, on Monday, December 4th. So a lot to look forward to.
Gotta love that. And believe me, as we get closer and closer to Advent and then, of course, the full-blown Christmas season, there'll be a lot more opportunities to come up. And we are your place to know about all those, to check it out each morning here on Morning Offering with Ron and Dave. And our word for today on this memorial of the presentation of the Blessed Virgin Mary on this Tuesday, November the 21st, our word for today is lost. Lost is our word for today. Here to talk about it as she is with us each Tuesday, it's Kendra Von Esch. Good morning, Kendra.
Oh, good morning, gentlemen. How are you two doing today?
Doing fabulous.
Not bad,
how are you?
Not bad.
Excellent, excellent. All right, so lost. I can't help but think about driving. And we have these awesome GPS systems. I don't know about you, but I particularly like Waze, W-A-Z-E, for everyone out there who doesn't know what that is, because it tells you when police officers are around the corner.
Ooh.
And I don't know, every now and then I get a little lead foot on me, so that's my favorite GPS app. But how many times have I tried to outsmart my GPS, right? Only to get myself into more traffic or even later to an appointment. And so I look at that as our life. So we need God. Our GPS is the God positioning system. And you're right.
Yeah.
And that's kind of where I looked at my first 43 years, let's say, of my life when I was so lost.
Mm.
I was outsmarting God's positioning system, trying to do life my way. And once we find God and we can rest in his ways, and it's a struggle. I'm going to tell you, I kicked and screamed to every teaching of the Catholic Church. There was no doubt in my mind that God and I went around, I feel like Jacob, wrestling with him. And I don't think I won. I hope I got the blessings at the end. But I had to change my life, and I couldn't do it on my own. I was lost. I didn't realize how much I needed God and how much I needed prayer, how much I needed to pay attention every day and fight the spiritual war, to know that the temptations that are coming my way could be demonic attacks on me. So pay attention and fight with all of the weapons that God gave us. So if you're feeling lost out there, I'll tell you right now, I am sitting in a hospital. My dad's been in here since October 30th, and I feel kind of lost. You know, I'm weaving my way through this, all this medical jargon and doing research. And the only reason I'm so peaceful and the only reason I'm taking it day by day is because of God, my God positioning system. I do not take prayer and put it on the side. I am constantly talking and praying to him. I am looking at this horrific situation that I'm in, and I'm seeing blessings everywhere, guys. I mean, it's amazing when you rest in God and you trust in him. Jesus, I trust in you. I'm going to tell you that my father also had the anointing of the sick. My father, who hasn't been practicing for, I don't know how, 60-something years. What a beautiful blessing. So if there's anyone out there who feels lost, turn to God. Give him your heart. Ask the Holy Spirit to fill you with peace, to fill you with love and joy. And you won't be lost anymore. You will feel that you are now found in God's family.
What is your father's name, Kendra?
It's Ray.
Ray. Father, we thank you, and you are the father by whom every other father on earth is named. I thank you for Ray. I thank you for your presence with him right now. I thank you for this time of communion between you and Ray. We thank you for the situation that brought this moment about, and we thank you for the perfect plan you have for Ray for today. The perfect plan that you have for Ray today. We pray for everyone who is caring for him, the doctors, the nurses, all of those who are putting together his plan of care. But Father, I thank you most of all for the plan that you have for him, for good and not for evil, giving him a future and a hope, a future with you, a future of eternity, an eternal bliss with you. I thank you that this time is being spent in investment in that time that never ends. I thank you for him. I ask that you would be present with him. I ask that your angels would stand guard round about him, and in a particular way, that Our Lady would be there to comfort him, but not just him, all of those who love him. And we pray in a particular way for our sister Kendra today and her example for her father in this life of faith, that this would be the day, that this would continue to be the day, that this day, Ray, would draw closer to you. This day would end with him closer to you, as would the next day and the next day and the next day, until the day that you call him home to yourself. We thank you for him, and we entrust him to your eternal care through the intercession of our beloved Mother Mary, as we pray, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen and amen.
Wow, that was beautiful. Thank you. So I'm over here on mute crying.
Well, we're praying for you and praying for your father.
Beautiful prayer. Thank you. Thank you so much. I love you guys.
Love you too. And giving thanks. We are giving thanks today as we get ready for Thanksgiving. Kendra, God bless you. We look forward to being with you next Thursday.
God bless you. Have a great Thanksgiving. And to everyone out there in the listening audience, take care. We'll talk to you next Tuesday.
All right. Thank you so much. And our thoughts and prayers with you and your dad. All right. Thank you so much for joining us for this Tuesday edition of Morning Offering. You know, we played the Ohio State fight song earlier.
Yeah.
Because the big game is coming up noon in the big house there. Well,
yeah.
In Ann Arbor.
In Ann Arbor, yeah.
Coming up here. And, you know, the Ohio State fight song always inspires me. And I root for Ohio State.
Yeah, yeah.
And I must tell you that flat out. But I think Michigan State has the better fight song.
Michigan has the better fight song?
I think so.
Well, let's hear it.
Well, okay. Here we go. If, you know, it's equal time, right?
Yeah, and we want to give equal honor.
That's right.
We are all about treating everyone fairly here.
That's right. So here
I don't
go.
Know if you ever heard the lyrics to this one. I'm gonna include the lyrics.
Are you?
Yep.
No, I'm not sure if I want to play it. Yeah. Okay, here we go.
Yeah. All right, pull it down just a little bit.
Okay.
Pull it down. Now, this is a story all about how my life got flipped, turned upside down, and I'd like to take a minute and just sit right there, and I'll tell you how I became the Prince of Bel Air. Did you know that's the lyric?
I did not know that,
yeah.
No.
In West Philadelphia, born and raised on the playground was where I spent most of my... Okay, never mind. There we go. Go Michigan. Go Ohio State. Can't wait for the game on Saturday. It is such a proud moment for all of us to see these two teams.